ओके, हाउ आई वुड कम टू नो इफ समबडी इज आस्किंग क्वेश्चन और व्हाट?
मैम दे विल रेज देयर हैंड। स्टूडेंट आप अपना हैंड रेज करके बताइएगा, आपको आवाज आ रही है सर जी हमें।
हेलो, एवरीबॉडी कैन हियर मी? ओके गुड, आई होप ऑल ऑफ यू आर डूइंग गुड। सो वी आर स्टार्टिंग अ टॉपिक टुडे व्हिच इज मेल एब्जॉर्प्शन एंड माय मेन फोकस वुड बी ऑन सीलिएक डिजीज इट्स क्लिनिकल फीचर्स एंड मैनेजमेंट। आई वुड एम्फेसाइज ऑन क्लिनिकल फीचर्स एंड मैनेजमेंट मच बिकॉज दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन योर क्लिनिकल प्रैक्टिस। And there are certain questions in the end of my presentation which I would ask you randomly from any one of you. Okay? Okay, so I am starting now. What is malabsorption? It denotes disorders in which there is disruption of digestion and nutrient absorption. Malabsorption is inadequate assimilation of dietary substances due to defects in either digestion, absorption, or transport means. If there is some problem either these three process which is digestion, absorption and transport, there would be malabsorption which would be presented as diarrhea. Okay, and you can stop me if somebody wants to raise certain question. What is malabsorption? Just brief overview. It is actually inadequate transport of one or more of the constituent of normal diet from the intestinal lumen across the intestinal epithelium into the portal circulation is called malabsorption. Right? I'm repeating it. It is inadequate transport of one or more of the constituent of normal diet, either carbohydrate, fats, or proteins, from the lumen across the epithelium into the portal circulation is called malabsorption. It has got three phases, which are luminal phase, mucosal phase, and transport phase. It was a just brief overview of malabsorption. Okay, and these three phases are performed by which thing? Luminal digestion is performed by pancreatic enzymes. Mucosal digestion is performed by small bowel brush border enzymes, and mucosal absorption is done by small bowel mucosa or lymphatics. And the term malabsorption is commonly used when any of these phases are impaired. Okay, you should know also what are the sites of nutrient absorption. As you know, our small bowel constituted by duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. So from duodenum, what is being absorbed? Iron, calcium, magnesium, folic acid, water soluble vitamins, amino acids, and monosaccharides. The most important is iron. Okay, so if there is any pathology of duodenum, there will be iron deficiency anemia. Next is jejunum, which fatty acids, amino acids, water soluble vitamins, and monosaccharides are being absorbed. Ileum is most important site because there are many conditions which involves the ileum. Some of they are enteric fever, tuberculosis, abdominal tuberculosis. Okay, so ileum is most important site for absorption of vitamin B12, conjugated bile salts, fat soluble vitamins, monosaccharides, and fatty acids. Any question so far? Any question? Okay, now I will start my proper presentation. This was just overview of malabsorption. Okay, next thing is how a patient of malabsorption would present, like what features would a patient would present which would make you think of malabsorption syndrome. Clinical clues to malabsorption would be weight loss, fatigue due to anemia, because there would be impaired absorption of nutrients. Intake of excess calories without weight gain. There would be diarrhea, which would be bulky and oily stools and excess platelets. Okay, I will repeat these clues time and again in order to make you memorize. So clinical clues of malabsorption would be weight loss, fatigue, intake of excess calories without weight gain, diarrhea, and excess platelets. And what would be the evidence, like clinical findings in a patient with deficiencies? Lositis and pilosis. Have you heard of this term? Have you heard of this term? Or should I tell you more? Have you heard of this term? Okay, glossitis is inflammation or swelling of tongue. And it is due to deficiency of iron and vitamin B complex. And what is pilosis? Pilosis is due to deficiency of vitamin. There is cracking of angle of mouth. I will show you a picture shortly. So glossitis and pilosis due to a deficiency of iron and vitamin B complex. Next is acrodermatitis. It is due to deficiency of zinc. Next is dry skin and hair. It is due to essential fatty acid deficiency. And anemia deficiency, it would be either microcytic or macrocytic. Have you heard of the term microcytic or macrocytic anemia? Have you heard of the term microcytic or macrocytic anemia? Okay, microcytic anemia is due to iron deficiency and macrocytic anemia is due to folate or B12 deficiency. Okay. There would be osteopenia or osteoporosis due to deficiency of vitamin D and calcium. There would be night blindness due to vitamin A deficiency and easy bruising due to vitamin K deficiency. Okay. Any problem? You can raise your hand if any problem, because there would be questions in the end. Okay. Any problem? Okay, okay. Now move on. This is picture of angular pilosis. You can see here cracking at the angle of mouth, and it is due to deficiency of vitamin B complex. This is due to deficiency of zinc. It is called as acrodermatitis. You can see chronic eczematous eruption due to deficiency of zinc. Okay. Now manifestations. And deficiency of nutrients would present in what way? If there is deficiency of fats, proteins, carbohydrates, it would present a foul-smelling diarrhea. There would be muscle wasting. There would be anemia, which can be either microcytic or macrocytic. And if deficiency of both are present, there can be even normocytic anemia. So you can get a question in your exam, okay, what type of anemia you can get in Mayer-Duchenne syndrome. You can get any type of anemia, either microcytic or macrocytic or even normocytic, right? Okay, due to deficiency of, okay, Mr. Vakas, Mr. Vakas?
Yes, Dr. Sidra, yes.
Okay. Here it is written, ki ask to unmute. What does it mean that some of the students ke paas likha hua aa raha hai, ask to unmute?
Ma'am, kuch students apna mic unmute karna chah rahe hain. अगर आप यस कर देंगी तो उनका माइक अनम्यूट हो जाएगा।
डू दे वांट टू आस्क क्वेश्चन और वैसे ही या वैसे ही करना है?
अब मैम अनम्यूट कर दें, अगर उनका क्वेश्चन होगा तो वो पूछ लेंगे, वैसे ज्यादातर एंड में पूछते हैं क्वेश्चन स्टूडेंट।
अच्छा ठीक है, सही। ओके, सो देयर वुड बी फाउल स्मेलिंग डायरिया, मसल वेस्टिंग एंड एनीमिया. There would be tetany, bone pain due to deficiency of calcium and vitamin D. Due to deficiency of vitamin K, there would be bleeding tendency and bruising. There will be edema due to protein deficiency. Edema would be fetal edema, which would be fitting one. And do you know in which condition you get non-fitting edema? In which condition you get non-fitting edema? Anybody? In which condition you get non-fitting edema? Anyone? Okay, non-fitting edema you get in only two conditions, hypothyroidism and lymphatic obstruction. Okay, but in protein deficiency you get fitting edema. And due to deficiency of lactose, there would be milk intolerance, right? Okay, next. Now celiac disease. Have you heard of term celiac disease? It is very important topic for exam purpose and for your clinical practice even. It is also known as non-tropical screw, celiac screw or gluten sensitive enteropathy. And how would you define as? It is chronic inflammatory autoimmune disorder that results in damage to the lining of the small intestine when gluten is ingested by genetically susceptible individuals, right? I'm repeating it. It's a chronic inflammatory autoimmune disorder that results in damage to small bowel lining when people who are genetically susceptible ingest food contains gluten. Okay? Okay? How many of you have memorized this definition? Answer me, how many of you have memorized this condition? Any problem? Okay, I'm repeating one more time. It's a chronic autoimmune inflammatory disorder that results in damage to the small bowel in genetically susceptible individuals when foods which contain gluten are ingested. Okay. It is the most common genetically food-related intolerance worldwide. It is a multifactorial disease. Autoimmune usually that occurs in genetically susceptible individuals. And it is triggered by well-defined environmental factor that is gluten and related prolamine present in wheat, rye, barley and oats. Okay? This is a question which would be asked in your exam. What are the foods, major foods that contain gluten? This is wheat, which is gandum. Rye is rye. Barley is jow. Oat is jai. Urdu mein I am telling because patients might tell you in Urdu, right? Wheat, rye, barley and oats. Wheat is gandum, rye is rye, barley is jow, oats are jai. Okay? You can make a mnemonic even grow. B-R-O-W. B, barley, R for rye, O for oats and W for wheat. Right? Gluten is a substance which is found in variety of foods including like the thing which I mentioned, bro, bread, pasta, cereals, processed food. So you need to avoid it in a patient with celiac disease. And what is pathophysiology? Enzyme tissue transglutaminase has been discovered to be the autoantigen against which the abnormal immune response is directed. Okay. This is the enzyme tissue transglutaminase has been discovered to be the autoantigen against which the abnormal immune response is directed. So that's why when we come on investigation, we get antibody against this enzyme. Okay. Gluten is a single major environmental factor that triggers celiac disease, which has a narrow and highly specific association with class 2 haplocytes of HLA-DQ2 and to a lesser extent DQ8. Okay. This is the inflammatory process which is generated by T cells that leads to disruption of structure and function of small bowel's mucosal lining and causes malabsorption as it impairs the body's ability to absorb nutrients, minerals and fat-soluble vitamins from food. Okay. Lactose intolerance may be present due to decreased bowel surface, reduced production of lactase, but typically resolves once the treatment is initiated. Okay. What are the risk modifiers? In fact, these are some of the thought process, okay? Infection by rotavirus. Smoking is protective but doesn't mean you start smoking, okay? Timing of the exposure to gluten in childhood is an important risk modifier. And prolonging breastfeeding until the production of gluten-containing grains into the diet is associated with 52% reduced risk of developing celiac disease in infancy. Any question so far you can ask me. Any question? Any question, students? Okay. Can anybody write definition of celiac disease, what I told? Anybody can write? Can anybody write a definition of celiac disease? What is celiac disease? It's a very important topic. That's why I'm repeating. It's a chronic inflammatory autoimmune disorder which results in inflammation of lining of small bowel when a person who is genetically susceptible ingests food contains gluten. Very good. Very good. Very good. Okay. And what are the foods which contain gluten? What are the foods which contain gluten? The mole is ब्रो, ठीक है, नमोने किस ब्रो, बार्ले, सही है, बार्ले राय ओट्स एंड व्हीट, वेरी गुड वेरी गुड, ठीक है, ओके. हाउ अ पेशेंट वुड प्रेजेंट, सिम्टम्स मे बी टिपिकल, सिम्टम्स मे बी एटिपिकल और इट मे बी इवन सडन. ओके, टिपिकल सिम्टम्स मीन पेशेंट वुड प्रेजेंट विद डायरिया एंड ही वुड से इन हिस्ट्री माय डायरिया वर्स व्हेन आई ईट वीट और बीफ रिलेटेड प्रोडक्ट्स, लाइक ही वुड से उर्दू के जब मैं रोटी खाता हूँ मेरा डायरिया ज्यादा वर्स होता है, जब मैं राइस खाता हूँ तो मेरा डायरिया इतना वर्स नहीं होता, तो दैट वुड गिव यू अ क्लू. ओके, एटिपिकल सिम्टम्स यूजुअली देयर टिपिकल जीआई सिम्टम्स वुड बी मिनिमल एंड एक्स्ट्रा इंटेस्टिनल मैनिफेस्टेशंस कैन बी देयर लाइक रैश. ओके, साइलेंट इट मींस के देयर आर नो सिम्टम्स बट व्हेन इफ देयर इज सर्टेन ट्रिगर इट कैन फ्लेयर एंड इफ यू गेट एंटीबॉडीज इट वुड बी पॉजिटिव. ओके, so what are the clinical features, there are questions in the end of my presentation so please listen carefully. Okay, clinical features can present at any age, in infancy it presents with diarrhea, typical symptom with diarrhea and failure to thrive, in older children delayed growth leading to short stature and pubertal delay. Okay, in adults usually females affected twice as males and presents usually third to fourth decade of life. Presentation is highly variable depending on severity and extent of small bone. What are the typical symptoms? Chronic or recurrent diarrhea. This will be worse on eating wheat containing products. There would be weight loss, tiredness due to anemia, muscle wasting due to protein deficiency, oral ulcerations due to vitamin deficiencies, abdominal bloating and dyspepsia, osteoporosis, reduced fertility, depression, and dermatitis herpetiformis. Even a patient, young female can come to you that she is unable to conceive. Okay, and you get her investigation, she is anemic. And there is a family history of autoimmune disease. So you should think of celiac disease in that patient. Okay, because one autoimmune disease increase the risk of having other autoimmune disease. And what is dermatitis herpetiformis, we will discuss shortly. So this is the picture depicting the clinical features of celiac disease. In mouth, there would be ulcer and tooth enamel erosion. There would be joint pain and swelling, stomach pain and nausea. In skin, there would be brittle nails, acne or eczema, diarrhea, constipation. In female, there can be infertility or subfertility, miscarriage and early menopause. Apart from these, there can be lactose tolerance, anemia, dizziness, dizziness due to anemia, obviously, migraine, depression, and chronic fatigue. Okay, I think all of you must be aware of the clinical features of celiac disease, isn't it? And there's also a mnemonic, malnourished. I am writing in chat box. There is a mnemonic, malnourished. Okay. There is a mnemonic, malnourished, or signs and symptoms. If somebody asks you sign and symptom, you can remember mnemonic, malnourished. M for mouth ulcers, A for anemia, L for lactose intolerance, N for nausea vomiting, O for osteo changes like bone thinning, osteoporosis, U for unexplained weight loss, R for rash, that is dermatitis herpetiformis, I for irregular periods and irritability, S for stool greasy and odorous, H for hair loss, and E for enamel deformity or enamel problem. Okay, so mnemonic is malnourished. Okay, what is mnemonic? Malnourished. Okay, any problem so far? Any problem? Okay, we move on now. Dermatitis herpetiformis is a cutaneous variant of celiac disease in which there are itchy blisters, very itchy blisters, especially over elbows, knees, back, and buttocks. Any extensive surfaces, there would be itchy blisters. It occurs in less than 10% of celiac patients. and this does respond to gluten-free diet. But some patient needs Dapsone. This is a drug Dapsone, which you must have read in your pharmacology. Dapsone, okay. This is the typical dress of dermatitis herpetiformis. You can see. Okay, this is very important. What are the disease association of celiac disease? There are certain disease which are associated with celiac disease, which we must think if a patient presents. Like diabetes type 1, a patient with celiac disease presenting with polyuria, polydipsia, lethargy, you should screen him for diabetes. He is presenting with palpitations, insomnia, racing of heart, you should think of hyperthyroidism. So these are the disease association: diabetes, thyroid, primary biliary cirrhosis, Addison's disease, Sjögren's syndrome, myasthenia gravis, dermatitis herpetiformis, ulcerative jejunitis, very important, splenic atrophy, lymphoma. Okay, so these are the disease association of celiac disease. I'm repeating: diabetes, thyroid, Addison's disease, myasthenia gravis, dermatitis herpetiformis, splenic atrophy, lymphomas. Okay, now the question is, who should be tested for celiac disease? Unexplained symptoms like chronic or intermittent diarrhea, failure to thrive, delayed puberty, iron deficiency anemia, chronic fatigue syndrome, any rash. These are the unexplained symptoms which you should think to make him screen for celiac disease. And what asymptomatic patient you should think to screen for? Type 1 diabetes, autoimmune thyroid disease, autoimmune liver disease, Down syndrome, Turner syndrome, and first degree relatives of patients with celiac disease. Okay. Any problem so far? Any problem so far? Okay. Now investigations. Gold standard is a duodenal biopsy. What does it show? It shows villus atrophy, excess number of intraepithelial lymphocytes, and crypt cell hyperplasia. You can see in picture, this is the normal small bowel biopsy picture, and this is the abnormal. In this you can see there is blunting of villi. Okay, this is typical of celiac screw. In this you can see there is blunting of villi and many intraepithelial lymphocytes you can see. Gold standard is biopsy. Other supportive tests are antibodies test. What are they? IgA tissue transglutaminase antibody, which is 98% sensitive and specific. And IgG tissue transglutaminase antibody, especially in patients, because some patients are IgA deficient, so there won't be IgA antibody. And third is IgA anti-endomycel antibody. Routine labs, what would it show? CBC, it would show anemia, which can be macrocytic or microcytic. How you would come to know microcytic or macrocytic? In microcytic, MCV would be low. In macrocytic, MCV would be high. Okay. So this can come in your question, like in microcytic anemia, what is found? You can write MCV would be low. Okay. In other tests, there would be low calcium. Okay, because due to there is malabsorption, low albumin, low vitamin D, low vitamin B12, and low folate. There would be increased alkaline phosphatase and increased PTINR due to deficiency of vitamin K. And DEXA scan would be done in order to rule out osteoporosis. Okay. What is the management? The only effective management is lifelong gluten-free diet. Rice, soya bean, potato, corn flour are safe. Strict adherence to diet allows the intestines to heal, leading to resolution of all symptoms in most cases, and depending on how soon that treatment is begun, and can also eliminate the heightened risk of osteoporosis and intestinal cancer. So earlier the treatment, better the prognosis. This is the gluten containing food: barley, wheat, rye, and oats. Okay, oats you can introduce later once the disease is controlled. Okay. So management is mainly dietary counseling and patient education, exclusion of wheat, rye, barley, and oats, lifelong gluten-free diet, and correct deficiency of iron, calcium, vitamin D, and folate. Improvement in symptoms should be evident within few weeks of gluten-free diet. And most common reason for treatment failure is incomplete removal of gluten. So in follow-up, you should assess for dietary compliance, assessment of symptoms like weight gain, there's diarrhea, no diarrhea, nutritional status, you should look for oral cavity and rash. Levels of antibody usually turn negative after 3 to 24 months of dietary gluten withdrawal. And repeat small bowel biopsy usually not required. Okay. So patient education is mandatory. And you should assess a patient's ability to read a food label which contains gluten or not. It's very important. Okay. Resistant cases usually require steroids or immunosuppressive drugs. What are the complications of celiac disease? Increased risk of malignancy. Okay. Especially lymphomas, small cell squamous cell carcinoma of esophagus and bowel carcinoma. Second complication, first malignancy complication, second ulcerative jejunalitis that would present with abdominal pain, perforation, obstruction and fever. Third complication, association with other autoimmune disease, and then complication of nutritional deficiency like anemia, osteoporosis and peripheral neuropathy. Why peripheral neuropathy? Due to deficiency of vitamin B12. Okay, and repeating again, complications, malignancies, ulcerative jejunalitis, association with other autoimmune disease and complications of nutritional deficiency. Okay. If appropriately diagnosed and treated, excellent prognosis. Celiac disease. Okay. So any questions so far on celiac, you can ask me. Are you like this currently or not? Any questions so far? Any question? Mr. Vakas, ये students से questions आपने पूछेंगे या कब पूछेंगे अगर होंगे कुछ?
मैम अभी पूछ भी रहे हैं, चैट पे देख लीजिए, चैट पे एक स्टूडेंट ने कुछ लिखा है।
चैट पे अच्छा। मेलनरिश। मेलनरिश ओके, आई एम रिपीटिंग मेलनरिश ओके। मेलनरिश M for mouth ulcers, A for anemia, M for mouth ulcers. A for anemia, L for lactose intolerance, okay, N for nausea vomiting, O for osteo changes means bone thinning, bone changes, U for unexplained weight loss and slow growth, R for rash, that is dermatitis herpetiformis, I for irregular periods or irritability, S for stool greasy and odorous, S for hair loss, E for enamel deform. Silent celiac disease clinically significant. It can be clinically significant later, and if the patient is having other autoimmune disease, then it is very significant. Next question. Usually, when a patient is diagnosed celiac disease, oats are usually withdrawn. But as patients respond, oats can be given gradually. Okay, so all of you are cleared of mnemonics, malnourish and rose, and oats can be given later on once disease is controlled. Okay, any other question? All of you are awake or not? Okay, I am sharing the video now. Mr. Vakas, I need to share a video, so how I would share then?
मैम आप वो वीडियो पहले तो आप प्रेजेंटेशन को स्टॉप कर दें।
कहाँ से करूँ प्रेजेंटेशन?
क्योंकि सामने स्टॉप शेयरिंग का ऑप्शन आ रहा होगा आपके पास।
स्टॉप शेयर का ठीक है, सही है।
ठीक है, अब आप मैम अपनी स्क्रीन वीडियो पहले आप ओपन कर लीजिए। कौन सी वीडियो? अपने कंप्यूटर पे ओपन कर लीजिए। अभी नहीं देख पा रहे, अभी आप शेयर स्क्रीन करें, शेयर स्क्रीन पे जाए और अपनी देखिएगा, स्क्रीन शेयर का ऑप्शन आ रहा होगा डेस्कटॉप का।
ठीक है, सही है, ठीक है, अब आ गया, अब यू कैन हियर। ओके स्टूडेंट, दिस इज अ वीडियो, शॉर्ट वीडियो ऑन ग्लूटेन ऑन सीलिया डिजीज, सो एंजॉय दिस वीडियो।
It is found naturally in some grains, such as wheat, barley, and rye. Nope, not you, rice. Common food products that have gluten include pastas, cereal, and bread. Sometimes gluten can also sneak its way into products like vitamins and supplements, lip balms, and some hair and skin products. Most people don't have a problem with gluten, but some people can't eat it because of an autoimmune disorder called celiac disease. The gluten makes them feel sick. Celiac disease sometimes is hereditary, meaning it runs in families. It's also very common. As many as one out of every 141 people in the United States has celiac disease. But most people who have celiac disease don't even know they have it. In celiac disease, gluten can trigger the immune system to attack the small intestine. Immune cells damage small finger-like growths in the small intestine called villi, and the brushy intestinal lining becomes flattened. When the villi are damaged, the body can't get the nutrients it needs. The immune system's reaction can lead to other health problems as well. Symptoms of celiac disease in adults may include headaches, depression or anxiety, tiredness, bone or joint pain, and a very itchy skin rash with blisters called dermatitis herpetiformis. And in children, stomach pain, nausea and vomiting, slowed growth, and delayed puberty. If untreated, celiac disease can lead to serious complications like anemia, infertility, and weak and brittle bones. Celiac disease can be difficult to diagnose because it looks like many other diseases. If your doctor thinks you might have celiac disease, you may need blood tests looking for antibody markers like TTGA and EMA. The diagnosis can also be confirmed with a biopsy. A tiny tissue sample is obtained under anesthesia using a thin tube called an endoscope. The good news is there's a treatment following a gluten-free diet. Patients need to learn what to eat and what to avoid, and to read nutrition labels carefully. For most people, following this diet will fix the symptoms and heal damage to the small intestine. But for some people, diet alone doesn't work. Finding hidden sources of gluten you may still be eating or using can help. Through the National
Okay, I think now there are other maladaptive syndromes as well which I need to discuss. I hope you are all are clear of celiac disease, right? Now, tropical screw. What is tropical screw? It is a chronic progressive malabsorption in a patient in or from the tropics. It means there would be history that patient is living or recently posted to tropical area, especially Malaysia, Indonesia, West Indies, and South India. It is associated with abnormalities of small intestine structure and function. So, celiac disease for non-tropical screw, it is tropical screw. In tropical screw, an infective agent may be involved, and presentations would be the same like diarrhea, weight loss, fatigue, but there would be fever. The differentiating point of tropical screw from non-tropical celiac disease, that in tropical screw there would be history that the patient is living in tropical area. Patient give history of fever because an infectious agent may be involved. And what is treatment? As infectious agent is involved, treatment would be antibiotic. Tetracycline is usually given for 28 days, folic acid, and we will ask the patient to leave the tropical area if possible, right? So tropical is a screw. If in the question there is written, there is a patient who has posted to tropical area and presented with diarrhea and living in West Indies, so you would think of tropical screw. And what would be the treatment? Antibiotic. At least name the antibiotic, tetracycline. What would be the second step of management? Folic acid. Third step, leave the tropical area. Any question? Any question regarding tropical screw? Okay, third is bacterial overgrowth. As the name suggests, disorder which impair normal physiological mechanisms controlling bacterial proliferation in intestines predispose to bacterial overgrowth. And what are the mechanisms? Four mechanisms are there. One is hypo or achlorhydria. Second is impaired intestinal motility. Third is structural abnormalities, and fourth is impaired immune function. So hypo or achlorhydria means there is less acid, less HCl, which is being formed due in patients with pernicious anemia, if patient underwent partial stomach surgery, if a patient is long-term proton pump therapy. So low acid would be fine in these conditions, and these things proliferate small bowel bacteria. Second is impaired intestinal motility, which is found in diabetes, very common, scleroderma, which is an autoimmune condition. And third is chronic intestinal pseudoobstruction. So a scenario can be given to you, a young female who is a known case of scleroderma presenting with diarrhea. So what would be the cause of diarrhea in that patient? Small bowel bacterial overgrowth. And what will be the mechanism in scleroderma? Impaired intestinal motility. I am repeating this because this is question is usually found asked in exam, right? Okay, these are the four mechanisms: hyperachloridria, impaired intestinal motility, structural abnormalities. Structural abnormalities like if there is excessive fistula, surgeries, or strictures present. Fourth is impaired immune function due to hypogammaglobulinemia. It is written in Davidson. Okay, so what would be the clinical features? Excessive flatulence, weight loss, abdominal pain, chronic diarrhea, steatorrhea, and deficiency of vitamin A, D, and B12 and iron. How would you investigate diarrheal follow through or small bowel enema? Aspiration of jejunal contents. Okay. How would you investigate a patient with bacterial overgrowth, diarrheal follow through or small bowel enema? Aspiration of jejunal contents. There would be no B12 because the excess bacteria which are present, they utilize B12. So B12 levels would be low in a patient with bacterial overgrowth. Fourth is hydrogen breath cell. You will measure serially breath samples of hydrogen after ingestion of 50 gram glucose. And you ask the patient to take 50 gram glucose and then you measure breath samples. If bacteria are present in a small bowel, they rapidly metabolize it. Right? Okay. Management, underlying cause should be addressed, like if there's diabetes, the patient is on proton pump therapy, that should be addressed. Prostacyclin would be given for 7 days. You can give metronidazole or ciprofloxacin. Metronidazole is usually any flagyl, you all might have heard of it. And iron B12 replacement is very important. Antidiarrheal drugs can be given. So underlying cause should be addressed. Antibiotic tetracycline, metronidazole or ciprofloxacin, and IM B12 replacement. And for supportive relief, you can give antidiarrheal drugs. Third is Whipple disease. It's a multi-system disease. Typically, a patient would be middle-aged male who would present with different symptoms apart from GI symptoms. Like apart from chronic diarrhea, he would say he's pigmented, there is joint pain present, there is cough, there is depression. Okay. It's a multi-system disease, infiltration of small intestinal mucosa bypass positive foamy macrophages, and it is caused by gram-positive bacillus Trophorema whipple. These are the clinical features. GI features present in 70% of cases, like diarrhea, steatorrhea, weight loss, pain. Musculoskeletal joint pain is very important symptom in whipple disease. Okay, so in a scenario, if there is written diarrhea with joint pain, you should think of whipple disease. And with middle-aged male, it's more common in males, while celiac is more common in females. Other symptoms involve cardiac symptoms, neurological symptoms, pulmonary symptoms. Okay. Middle-aged men mostly affected, low-grade fever common, and presentation depends on pattern of organ involvement. And how would you treat Whipple disease? IV ceftriaxone, that is rosuvastatin, 2 gram OD once a day in India for 2 weeks, followed by oral cotrimoxazole for 1 year. So you have to treat this disease for long period. Right. Fourth is short bowel syndrome. Malabsorption resulting from extensive small intestinal surgeries, like in children there is congenital anomalies, and in adults Crohn's disease, valvulus, or radiation enteritis. In radiation enteritis, and if there is a question of a female patient who is having malignancy of her uterus or ovaries, underwent radiotherapy, what is the cause of diarrhea? Usually cause of diarrhea would be radiation enteritis, right? Okay. What are the types of three main types of resection? Jejunal resection, jejunal or ileal, jejunal and ileal resection, and colectomy. Because the presentation would depend how much the intestine is removed. Obviously, if jejunum, ileum, and colon is removed, the presentation would be more lethal, right? Would be more severe. What is the management? TPN. TPN management in immediate post operative far enteral, you need to give nutrition. Enteral feeding after 1 to 2 weeks, detailed nutritional assessment, fluid electrolyte balance, replacement of vitamins. You can give, if there is very diarrhea, high amount of diarrhea, you can give loperamide or codeine. And octreotide is a substance that is used to reduce GI secretions. this is a question can be asked in your MCQs. What is named the drug which is used to reduce GI secretions? You would say Ocrio.